Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the fourth meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Our first item of business today is a decision to take item 6 in private. Are we all agreed? Yes. Brilliant. Thank you. We are all agreed. Next this morning is consideration of two statutory instruments, the Social Security Uprating Miscellaneous Amendments Scotland Regulations 2023 and the Social Security Uprating Scotland Order 2023. At our last committee meeting, we took evidence from the Scottish Commission on Social Security on their recommendations for the 2023 uprating regulations and the Scottish Government's response to their report. I welcome Ben McPherson, MSP, Minister for Social Security and Local Government, and I also welcome officials. Joining us in the room, we have Simon Coote, Head of the Cross-Cutting Policy Unit, and Camilo Arredondo, Solicitor, and I hope I have pronounced your name correctly. And joining us remotely, we have Dominic Mellon, Economic Advisor, Social Security Analysis, Forecasting and Evaluation Branch for the Scottish Government. So a few quick points just to mention about the format of the meeting before we begin. For officials attending remotely, please allow our broadcasting colleagues just a few seconds to turn your microphone on before you start to speak if the Minister wishes to bring you in. For members attending remotely, please wait until I say your name before speaking. And colleagues in the room should indicate to myself or the clerk if they wish to come in and ask a supplementary question. Members online, just use the chat box or the WhatsApp. The instruments are laid under the affirmative procedure, which means the Parliament must approve them before they come into force. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited in upcoming agenda items to consider motions to approve each of the instruments separately. I remind everyone that Scottish Government officials can speak under this item, but not in the debate that follows. So I will now invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, colleagues. I welcome this opportunity to assist the committee in its consideration of the draft Social Security Uprating Order 2023 and the draft Social Security Uprating Scotland Miscellaneous Amendments Regulations 2023. The draft Social Security Uprating Order 2023 provides for the uprating of benefits administered in Scotland by the Department of Work and Pensions. And the draft Social Security Uprating Scotland Miscellaneous Amendments Regulations 2023 provide for the uprating of devolved benefits administered by the Scottish Government. The laid instruments provide a 10.1% increase in support covering all devolved benefits, excluding the Scottish Child Payment, for which uprating was included in the 25% in-year increase. This means we are uprating all those benefits where there is a statutory requirement for us to do so, and have additionally chosen to uprate those for which there is no statutory requirement for ministers to do so. As the committee is aware, we took that decision to increase the Scottish Child Payment from £20 to £25 per week in November 2022, a 25% increase. Now the eligibility has been extended to under 16-year-olds. This will benefit more than 300,000 children across Scotland in the financial year 23-24. Scottish Government analysis estimates this payment could reduce the relative child poverty rate in Scotland by 5 percentage points in 23-24, lifting around 50,000 children out of relative poverty. We have taken these decisions on uprating in recognition of the difficulties facing people in Scotland during the ongoing cost of living crisis, which has seen inflation rates reach a 40-year high over recent months. Convener, this means that, subject to parliamentary approval, these new rates will come into force in April 2023, the rates in the regulations before us. And so I'd like to thank the committee for its scrutiny and consideration of these operating instruments and urge colleagues to welcome and support them.
Thanks very much, Minister. We'll now move on to questions from members. Our questions will be directed to you, but obviously you are, of course, welcome to invite any official to respond. So on theme one, I will move to James Dornan online.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, Minister. A number of stakeholders have welcomed the uprating as a minimum required action, but have calls for increased payments. Payments to be increased further in order to address the cost of inflation, etc. Can you tell us, given this cost of living crisis, is this time for a review of the adequacy of our benefit payment levels? I'm going to be asking you another question along similar lines I do also recognise the difficulty that we have in increasing payments, given we live within a fixed budget.
Yeah, and these are such important questions and, of course, get to the heart of our considerations as a government and as a society as to how government can help people in these times. And that's why we have done a great deal within our limited powers and relatively fixed budgets to support those on the lowest incomes. So, for example, in 23-24, we are committing £776 million above the level of funding forecast to be received from the UK Government through block grant adjustments. So a really significant amount of additional investment in social security benefits from the Scottish Government. And as the instrument set out, we have chosen to increase the value of benefits where uprating is not a statutory requirement, in recognition of the difficulties faced by many due to the increased cost of living. We, of course, also provided enhanced uprating of 6% to a range of devolved benefits in 2022, so the last financial year, despite the fact that the September CPI rate at that time was 3.1%. So we gave a significant uplift in the last financial year, as well as doing so in this. Of course, we have increased the Scottish Child Payment, first of all, from £10 to £20 per week in April 2022, which was an increase of 100%, and then, of course, increased it again to from £20 to £25 from November 2022. So a really significant amount of additional support. And these choices all represent increases to the value of benefits beyond the statutory uprating requirements, as I've emphasised. And, you know, compared to UK equivalents, so as well as the Scottish Child Payment, compared with UK equivalents, our other payments are already more generous than those available in the UK social security system. For example, Best Start Grant Pregnancy and Baby Payment is currently £642.35 compared to £500 for Sure Start Maternity Grant, the UK equivalent. So that's a difference of £142.35. Also in Scotland, we have the Best Start Grant Pregnancy and Baby Payment for subsequent children currently at £321.20, which there is no UK equivalent. And the three Scottish Best Start food payments are also more generous in value than the rest of the UK Healthy Start equivalents. So through our seven benefits that are not available elsewhere in the UK, and also with our benefits where we that I've just outlined, where there is a UK equivalent, but we're being more generous and paying more, we are looking in the round to do as much as we can to provide that additional support within a largely fixed budget and of course with limited power.
Okay, convener, can I come back?
Absolutely, James, carry on if you have further questions.
Thank you. I've got a question around the high cost of food and energy as it is just now, but do you think then that £4.95 is an adequate rate for Best Start Foods? And is £55.05 an adequate rate for winter heating payments, given what you've just told us about being in the, you know, greater than it is in the rest of the UK, or doesn't exist in the rest of the UK?
In terms of Best Start Foods, there is no statutory requirement to uprate Best Start Foods, but despite that, we increased Best Start Foods in August 2021 from £4.25 to £4.50 a week. A rise which provides a weekly payment that is more generous than other parts of the UK, as I've already said. And once it's been uprated in April, should Committee and Parliament pass the regulations before us, once it's been uprated by 10.1%, Best Start Foods will provide £19.80 every 4 weeks throughout pregnancy, £39.60 every 4 weeks from birth until a child turns one, to support breastfeeding mothers or help with the costs of providing first infant formula milk, and then £19.80 every 4 weeks from the age of one and until the child turns three. And also, many recipients of Best Start Foods will also benefit from our other five family payments, which include the Scottish Child Payment and the three Best Start grants. Our five family payments could already be worth around £10,000 by the time an eligible family's child turns six, compared to around £1,800 for eligible families in England and Wales. So, really significant additional support, and over £20,000 by the time an eligible child is 16. With an expanded range of qualifying benefits compared with the UK Healthy Voucher Scheme, Best Start Foods also offers more choice by including a wider range of healthy foods for families to purchase. And members may have also seen that in recent weeks the Scottish Government has been trying to raise awareness of Best Start Foods and encouraging people to check their cards, to check if they're eligible and to utilise that support, because we really want people to get the benefit of it. In terms of winter heating payment, as members will be aware, winter heating payment has just been introduced this winter. We've discussed it, of course, at this committee. And for the first time, we'll provide a stable, reliable payment which will help around 400,000 low-income households and individuals with their heating expenses each winter. As I've said before, our new benefit is an investment of over £20 million each year, more than double the £8.3 million on average provided by the DWP in the last 7 years. And during that same seven-year period, on average, 185,000 people received support through the UK Government's cold weather payments, in comparison to our new benefit, which, as I've said, will provide support to around 400,000 people. And as has been highlighted in my opening remarks, we will uprate winter heating payment by 10.1% should Parliament pass the regulations before us. And this will, of course, provide additional support next winter. And members may also have seen the clarification yesterday that winter heating payment is being paid out as we speak. And that is something I think we should all welcome.
Thank you very much, Minister. I suspect everybody will be, whose receipt of that will be welcoming it. Okay, just before I finish, can you, as a minister in your position, can you guarantee to us that you will be arguing your case with the finance secretary, whoever that may be in the future, that this is a priority whenever any money becomes available within the Scottish Government?
Certainly, as ministers in the social justice portfolio, we press the case for additional support for social security through discussions with our colleagues who are finance ministers, and particularly if new resource emerges through the process of consequentials or reconsiderations in year around budget spend. But I should say as well that finance ministers are very committed to the social justice position, so it's a shared determination as a government, a national mission to tackle poverty. And you know, that's been demonstrated by the fact that the Deputy First Minister and Acting Finance Secretary has committed £428 million to uprating in the next financial year, and of course the £442 million for the Scottish Child Payment. So yes, we will continue to discuss in government collaboratively and with that shared determination to tackle poverty what more financial resource can be allocated to Social Security. As a government, we are absolutely focused on doing what we can to support people generally and particularly in these challenging times.
Thank you very much, Minister.
Thank you, James. We'll now move to questions from Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to Ministers and your officials. The 44% of carers are in poverty. About 40% of them have said that they're struggling to make ends meet. They can't afford essentials. 49% are struggling to afford the cost of food. 37% are in debt as a consequence of caring. And the number of carers that have cut back on essentials since 2021 has almost doubled. So has the Minister considered, at this juncture, doubling the carers' allowance supplement?
Certainly, that is an important issue and question, of course, not related to the regulations before us directly. Of course, that the carers allowance supplement will be uprated within these regulations by 10.1% overall, in line with other benefits.
Sorry, I'm confused then. How does it not relate?
So, the question around doubling the carers allowance supplement in the next financial year and considerations around once we get to that juncture in the next period. Sorry, Pam Duncan Glancy, I thought you were talking about the additional carers allowance supplement, so please excuse me.
Okay.
Of course, there's a relevancy, and I do apologise for that.
That's okay.
Misspeak there. Of course, the additional carers allowance supplement is something we were proud to introduce from 2018. It was the right thing to do. It was the first thing that was done by Social Security Scotland by the Minister at that time. It's provided a significant amount of additional support to carers, which is, of course, something we are determined to provide. There has been also through that period, the carers allowance additional supplement, which I was, of course, considering in the beginning of this answer, which has provided additional support both in the year of the pandemic and then in the winter of 2021. So how we continue to support carers is, of course, demonstrated in the fact that we are increasing the carers allowance supplement or wanting to in these regs and asking Parliament to support us in that. But also, of course, we are now moving to a position where we will be transferring into carer support payment and draw members' attention to the remarks that I made in Parliament in the debate just a number of weeks ago about that. And I will, of course, as I said in that debate, be shortly publishing the response to the consultation on carer support payment and the issues raised within that about how we provide additional support. Like all the benefits that we are responsible for, we are looking to provide additional support, and of course the carers allowance supplement and its increase by 10.1% in these regulations is part of that. But also we are, as members know, in a situation where we have to balance the budget across the Scottish Government as a whole, and given that we are providing £776 million of additional support above what we received from the UK Government from the block grant adjustment, given that we are providing new benefits that aren't available elsewhere in the UK, including the carers allowance supplement, I think this Government demonstrates on a consistent basis that we are seeking to provide additional financial support where and when we can. You know, we've just passed a budget as a Parliament in this week. The financial situation is incredibly challenging. Finding additional support is difficult, but where we are able to secure additional support, like the £428 million that is committed to this operating that we're considering today across the board, we are seeking to step up and do that.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And I think my understanding is that of that 400 odd million, about 28 million is coming from your budget, and the rest is, I believe, coming from Barnett consequentials.
That is, if I may just speak on that point, convener, and thank you, Pam Duncan Glancy. So, of course, there is that aspect of the 428 million that is support, is operating with regard to benefits. That we are making a commitment to operate where there isn't a statute to do so. But you've got to also remember that then there's that additional social security that's not provided elsewhere in the UK, like the £442 million for the Scottish Child Payment. So, you know, let's just keep that mind in mind in terms of the wider perspective.
appreciate that. Thank you. It will probably come as no surprise to anyone to hear me say that I think there are other revenue raising options that the government has if it were to choose to consider doing things like doubling the carers line supplement. To move on from that, we know that the inflation rate for people on low incomes is higher for people on other incomes, and that they spend about 46% of their income on things like food and energy, which is why that is the case. So did the government explore other options when considering the uprating, and what impact does it think the current uprating will have given families on low incomes, which a number of the benefits that you've already highlighted and the Minister's already spoken about today target those groups?
So, of course, the considerations around those on low incomes are at the heart of everything we're doing with our social security system. The additional benefits that we provide to households that are not available elsewhere in the UK are absolutely targeted at those low-income households. You know, the Scottish Child Payment having that impact for over 300,000 children, all of which are receiving reserve benefits, which then allow them to access the Scottish Child Payment, are related to the fact that they are in low-income households. So there's that additional support, that £442 million for the Scottish Child Payment. In terms of the considerations around how we take matters into account with regard to what measures we consider when we're thinking about how to make sure that we're being responsive to low-income households when deciding uprating policy, Scottish Government analysis and the analysis that work for us. And I'll perhaps bring Dominic in shortly to say any more on this if he wishes to. Undertake an annual review of the potential inflation metrics to use to uprate benefits. The CPI has been consistently used to uprate benefits by both the Scottish Government and the UK Government, the DWP, as it is a leading measure of inflation used by the Office of National Statistics. It holds national statistics status, and there are CPI forecasts published regularly by the Office of Budget Responsibility and the Bank of England. We are aware of recent developments by the ONS and other stakeholders to develop supplementary price metrics to reflect that price rises in the economy do not affect all households equally, which are, of course, at the heart of your question, Pam Duncan-Glancy. For example, the ONS now publish CPI rates by income decile. So Scottish Government analysts use these additional price indices extensively in internal analysis and briefing of ministers. However, the ONS advise these types of price indices are experimental and caution against their use for anything other than research purposes at this juncture. So we are very focused on providing additional support to low-income households, which is why we provide the additional benefits that we do, the 7 benefits that aren't available elsewhere in the UK, and we keep in mind how we measure operating policy and how best to do that. And Dominic, I don't know if you want to say any more on that.
Yeah, thanks, Minister. I would just add that, as you say, we're very aware of these alternative supplementary price indices, and we do use those extensively in our work, as you say, and how we brief ministers. And we do take a steer from the ONS and the UK Statistics Authority and how we use those metrics and how we use those to spend taxpayer money. And ultimately, that's where we take our kind of steer from. So we'll continue to use those. But as the Minister said, we do defer to the national statistics, the CPI, in our kind of overall operating approach.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I just have one further question on this. We know, and Inclusion Scotland have made representations to this effect, that disabled people's energy costs have doubled, and that they had suggested that a number of disabled people access the winter heating payment that the Minister has previously mentioned. On that basis, they'd suggested that payment also be increased. In fact, I think in their briefing they said it had been doubled. What was your response to their request?
I cannot recall the specific request and correspondence that was potentially issued in response to that. But of course, we do consider, particularly in these times with the high cost of energy, what additional support can be provided. And that's why, for example, the creation and then paying for the last payment of during the last years of the child winter heating assistance has, of course, been so important in having that additional support for those households. Colleagues will be aware and remember that when we took through the regulations on the winter heating payment, I talked about the fact that we have deliberately drafted those regulations in order to provide flexibility for the government in the future, should it wish to pay either a higher amount or an additional payment of the winter heating payment. But of course, that is, again, it gets back to that is contingent on the financial resources available, which of course gets back to the thrust of the challenge, which is how do we provide more support in a situation where we have a largely fixed budget and also limited powers. And I think there will always be calls on the Scottish Government to do more, but I think it's also important to recognise, acknowledge and emphasise that collectively as a Parliament we are delivering more support for people in Scotland that is available elsewhere in the UK, and we are doing that with determination and dedication to help people and to make Scotland a more socially just place. So we absolutely appreciate the needs that people have and that there are demands for us to do more. But I also hope committee and members across the political spectrum appreciate that in good faith the Scottish Government is trying to do as much as it can with its resources, like the £428 million for this operating that we're considering today, like the £442 million for the Scottish Child Payment that's not available elsewhere, like additional benefits like child winter heating assistance.
Thank you. I'll stop there for just now. Thank you.
Thank you, Pam. Now move to questions from Paul McLennan.
Thanks, Convener. It's kind of moving on to item two, Minister, and welcome to you and your officials. It's kind of talking around about the uprating, and obviously it's just an approximate measure, and it's where the single reference month is used. I'm just wondering if you can say a little bit more on the advantages and disadvantages of that, and probably, I know Scottish Government's keeping policy under review around about what consideration has been given to the future, obviously, when you talk about the volatility of inflation in the last year. So just a comment on that. And I've got another question kind of related to that after that.
Thanks, Mr McLellan. And it's important to note that September CPI, as I've said, is a measure of price increases over the preceding 12 months to September, and not a measure of inflation during September alone. Devolved Scottish benefits will therefore be uprated in April 2023 with the September 22 12-month CPI rate, representing the overall change in prices faced by consumers over the year to September 2022. And as I said in my answer to Pam Duncan-Glancy, this is a leading measure of inflation published each month by the Office of National Statistics and is a national statistic. Officials assess alternative uprating options each year, including the use of a CPI rate closer to the time uprating will take effect. However, the September CPI rate was considered the most appropriate inflation period to use to uprate benefits in April 2023. The September CPI rate is published in October. Due to the time lag between the period covered by the data and its publication, using a later 12-month rate, or, for example, an average rate over 22-23, would introduce administrative challenges around setting the Scottish Government budget, which, of course, is published in December, and then implementing rate changes to benefits thereafter. It is also preferable to use outturn statistics to forecast as they reflect inflation that households have experienced to date, rather than predictions of inflation, which are inherently uncertain, and we've realised that particularly in recent times. In terms of your, you have a next question.
The next question was kind of talking, and you kind of touched on in an answer to Pam's question before, was talking about obviously inflation in low-income households, and obviously the proportion in low-income households, for example, around about energy and food costs, which have been exceptionally high this year, are obviously proven to be an issue. And again, I know inflation has been forecast to come down this year and so on, but food inflation is still high and energy costs are still high. And you mentioned around about the analysis of this is still almost just for, it's not really into the process yet. I'm just wondering if that, what the future plans are for maybe next year, the year after that, around about that specific work into low-income households and how that impacts on that. And that probably need, as you said, probably work in conjunction with the UK government, but I just wondered what your thoughts were on that in the next few years going ahead.
Yeah, unless you want me to, I won't repeat what I've laid out to Pam Duncan Glancy, but just to emphasise that the Scottish Government and our analysts take an annual review of the potential inflation metrics to use to uprate benefits into consideration. So we review that annually. Just to emphasise what we are doing for low-income households, I talked about the £442 million that we have allocated in our largely fixed budget for the Scottish Child Payment. As I emphasised in an answer to Mr Dornan, that now that the Scottish Child Payment is paid at £25 per week per child, our five family payments could be worth around £10,000 by the time a child turns six, compared to around £1,800 for eligible families in England and Wales, and then over £20,000 by the time a child turns 16. And that's really significant investment in helping low-income households, which is the right thing to do and why we're doing it and why we're determined to provide that support and be proactive about it. And then for subsequent children, these payments are worth £9,700 by the time a child turns 6 years old, compared to around £1,300 in England and Wales. Of course, we'd like people in England and Wales to get similar support, but we don't have determination over that. But here in Scotland, that's the extra support that we're providing to low-income households.
And I know that approach was backed up strongly by the IFS, obviously, when it mentioned that as well. Just one final question, convener, if that would be okay. One was really just kind of moving on to, and I've asked this question, and about fiscal flexibilities. And I know the discussions ongoing around with the UK government, the Scottish government, around about that. I don't know if there's anything you want to say on that particular round about the operating budget and how the block grant is adjusted and so on around about that. Is there something in these discussions that would benefit yourself in that regard?
I know the member's interest in this area, and I think it's an important discussion around how do we consider going forward, from the pandemic, from the cost of living crisis, how the Scottish Government is equipped in the most effective manner in order to be able to respond to issues that require additional financial support for people, but also are situations where there needs to be that extra capacity within the government's financial armoury, so to speak, in order to help people. Obviously this is more specifically a consideration for Finance Committee and Finance Ministers, but it of course has an impact
across... Probably coming from your own...
Absolutely, has an effect across different policy areas, and I think the argument for more borrowing powers for the Scottish Government becomes stronger all the time. The current fiscal framework arrangements clearly constrain the extent to which we can respond to this cost of living crisis and any crisis, because we need to operate within that largely fixed budget. Our ability to target funds to respond to any emerging crisis is therefore limited to reprioritising, as I emphasised to Pam Duncan-Glancy, from within an existing budget. And that is a significant limitation. That's the reality of it. And one which will rightly be pressing to UK ministers and the UK government as part of the upcoming renegotiation on the fiscal framework. The current arrangements, constrained borrowing and reserve powers, limit the Scottish Government's abilities, so we are dependent on decisions made by the UK Government. That was the case during the pandemic. That's been the case during the cost of living crisis, whether we've been able to pay more for example, the carers allowance additional supplement. We're able to pay more in 2021 because of additional resource being available. So additional flexibilities would allow the Scottish Government to mobilise and deploy funding in the most effective and efficient way to support our citizens. So the fiscal framework review must ensure that the Scottish Government and the Parliament have the necessary fiscal flexibility to manage the risks we face within our devolved responsibilities and to support economic recovery as well as households who need it. So in doing so, the review must ensure the government has the necessary levers to manage budget effectively and to respond to pressures and risks. So Social Security is certainly part of those considerations.
Demand led, yeah.
But again, I would emphasise that within the current arrangement, Social Security has certainly been prioritised to a large extent with that additional support that's being provided, that £776 million above what we received through the block grant adjustment.
Minister, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Paul. We'll now move on to questions from Faisal Chowdhury, who's joining us online.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. Would there be any provision for future payments of the winter fuel payment to be paid closer to the start of winter rather than the end?
Well, I think that's, again, an important question and one that we've discussed collectively in other sessions. And I have said on several occasions that when it comes to the winter heating payment, we will be reviewing in the months ahead the situation and how we consider whether payment in this period of the winter, in February and into March, is the right payment schedule for households. So we'll be engaging with a number of parties in order to consider what would be what may be a better arrangement for the coming winter, and so winter 23-24 and thereafter. And you know, I would just remind colleagues that considerations around when winter heating payment was able to be paid out this year were based on engagement that we had with stakeholders about when would be a good time for them to receive the payment. So we did that engagement. But also there was the reality of the fact that the Social Security Scotland were activating Scottish Child Payment 2 in November. Scottish Child Payment 2 is the shorthand descriptor for the increase to £25 and also the extension to under 16s. So Social Security Scotland was undertaking that new, very significant new payment arrangement in November, also paying out carers allowance supplement at that time, child winter heating assistance at that time. But importantly, as well as the matters that Social Security Scotland were contending with in that period at the end of last year, our colleagues in the DWP have also been under a lot of pressure with their cost of living payments, which is why they were only able to give us the data scan for winter heating payment on the 31st of January rather than at the beginning of January, which is when the Scottish Government asked for it and wanted it. But we were understanding of our colleagues in the DWP that they had a huge exercise to undertake to pay out their cost of living payments, and we agreed the 31st of January date, as that was the date that they could deliver to. And they did deliver to that date. We received the data. The data was effectively processed by Social Security Scotland, and payments have been going out in recent days and will be going out as we speak, and will be undertaken this month in February and in March as well.
Thank you very much, I've got a question on theme two. Can I go on that one, or do you want to wait till...
If you could hold off just now, because I've got a few supplementaries on the point that you just raised, and then I'll come back to you, Faisal. Sorry, can I just clarify on that point then? Obviously, you had said we had the Scottish Government has originally wanted the beginning of January. So in terms of going forward, will that be something that we're looking to? Obviously, we don't know what will be happening, sort of, because you're talking about the Scottish Child Payment in November and the other issues in terms of the cost of living crisis with the DWP. So, well, there is scope to move that payment date forward in the coming year, and that's something that you're... Yeah.
Absolutely, there is. And we will undertake an evaluation now of when would be the best time to pay the winter heating payment. And the significant delivery... The significant additional delivery demand that the Scottish Government took on the 14th of November, when Scottish Child Payment really increased in terms of eligibility to under 16s. I mean, we all know the demand in that week on the 14th of November last year, and what that undertaking in terms of the programming and making sure the systems were all set up and which they were very successfully, and everything has worked very, very well with Scottish Child Payment. So we'll not have that significant additional capacity being added to Social Security Scotland in the year ahead. However, we will be reliant on a data scan from the DWP, so we will have to negotiate and agree collectively with the DWP on a date for the data scan for winter heating payment in the winter ahead. And we will discuss that in good faith and in a collaborative way with the DWP, and that will be not necessarily impacted, but certainly somewhat contingent on the demands that DWP are also wrestling with at that time. And of course, one thing I encourage all members to do is to emphasise to DWP the prioritisation that MSPs place on a good engagement between the DWP and Social Security Scotland, because that's important for all the people in Scotland.
Thank you, Minister. OK, we have a few supplementaries just on that point, so I'll go to Miles Briggs first.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to your officials as well. I wanted to ask, on the back of these questions, what assessment has been made of the impact of this late or delayed payment to people, especially in rural Scotland, and whether or not you've reached out to any fuel poverty charities who are working in this area to find out what impact this has had, especially for people off-grid?
I'm happy to take that away and write with more detail to the member. I would say that our engagement with stakeholders working in issues around fuel poverty has been appropriate up until the creation of winter heating payment through the delivery, and certainly we'd be interested in hearing from any stakeholders about any feedback they may have around the issues Mr. Briggs has raised. Certainly, have made the committee aware following some of our discussions on winter heating payment, I did instruct Social Security Scotland to write to the local authorities in areas that had been historically the highest areas of people receiving cold weather payments, in order to emphasise what other support is available, for example, the Fuel Insecurity Fund. So there is appropriate engagement, open to more engagement, and I thank Mr. Briggs for raising the issue, and happy to take that away if he would like any further details on that that we may be able to provide following this in supplementary.
That'd be helpful. And the point you raised, do you welcome the fact, and I think I raised it in the chamber, that you've written to councils to make sure that they're highlighting. Do you know if that's been undertaken to make sure that people have been highlighted, what support could be available?
I can, because the letter went from the chief executive rather than from my office, so we can check what responses Social Security Scotland have had. But of course, we can urge councils to do things. We cannot, in this regard, instruct them to do so. But I would consider that in good faith. I'm sure that the councils are and have undertaken necessary and helpful proactive engagement with those in their communities as they consistently do.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Miles. And a supplementary from Pam?
Thanks very much, Convener. I'm struggling a bit, if I'm honest, because the child payment was announced a few years back, and eligibility for that payment was clearly to be from 0 to 16. And I appreciate that it was rolled out initially to under sixes and then to over sixes on the 14th of November last year. But that's something the government should have been planning for. So I'm not sure I accept that it's fair to say that Social Security Scotland was overstretched because of a surprise payment, because it's not really a surprise. It surely would have been in the making. And the other point is, and I take the point about this year not having that same pressure, but again, there are other benefits that are not rolled out yet in Social Security Scotland. So are we just going to keep seeing pressure on timescales because it feels like there's not much planning for that? And then my final question, but I suppose those are points or a question about the planning. My final question is, when did you ask the DWP for the data? Because my understanding when you appeared at committee, when the Minister, appeared at committee before Christmas, my understanding was that if the payments had been paid by the 31st, sorry, if the data had been shared by the 31st of January, then the payments would have been rolled out in a timely fashion as preferred. But when did the government, Scottish Government ask them to give them at the beginning of January?
So there were discussions late in 2022, throughout 2022, which concluded in late 2022 around the data scan. There had been a continued and consistent ambition from the Scottish Government once we settled on the February commencement of payments. And I've always said it's the commencement of payments from February. Once we settled on that position, we had discussed in 2022 with DWP, and this had been largely official level, about a determination that we had hoped and planned on receiving the data early in January, but DWP, because of the pressures with the cost of living payments, were unable to meet that position, but we then agreed the 31st of January. And I refute strongly the accusations that there is not adequate planning in Social Security.
Okay.
And I'm happy to commit my senior officials who work in programming agency and policy to come and speak to the committee, because the planning of the delivery of Social Security benefits in Scotland I think has been extremely professionally and remarkably delivered and considered, working in a hybrid system where we have to engage with the DWP and where we are still developing a new service that is performing well. And you've seen the feedback from clients, from people who've used the service, and how positive it is. The amount of new clients in a short period of time, and new people applying for benefits that were that made their applications for Scottish Child Payment in that November week, was a significant increase in client activity and demand on the service. And there was a huge amount of planning that went into that November date, and that's why it's been so successful, because You know, that required additional recruitment, obviously digital development, significant wider programming to make sure that everything was effective, and you know, payments are with Scottish Child Payment have been significantly issued, and I'll be able to provide further updates to Parliament on that in due course. But you know, I refute strongly any accusation that Scottish Child Payment extension was not properly planned. It was very well planned, and it has been very well executed, and it has helped thousands of people that wouldn't have got that support if it wasn't for Scottish Government initiative, and it's not available elsewhere in the UK. So, you know, I just have to be very strong about that.
Okay. Thanks.
Thanks, Minister. And just a final supplementary on that question from Jeremy.
Thank you, Convener. Before I ask my question, can I just declare an interest in this, that I am on the high rate of PIP, so I have a financial institution on one of financial benefit from one of the benefits we're talking about today. Can I just go back to the comment you made that it's now going to be reviewed, the winter payment? Now, clearly, the information sharing between the Scottish Government and DWP, the sooner that can happen, the better. So I just wondered, how quickly will that review take place, and how will it be reported?
In terms of the latter point around how it will be reported, I'm happy to update committee on that in due course as soon as I can. I have already instructed my officials to consider the timing of the benefit next year, or next winter rather.
I think we might return to this afternoon in one of my questions to you, but I just wonder, can you give us, I mean, are we looking before summer, are we looking after summer, are we looking, you know, is there at least some kind of timescale we can be looking at to look out for this information?
So the priority for the Scottish Government is to pay the winter heating payment, which is happening as we speak, and is all scheduled to be paid in this month and into next. And we will make sure that those payments, which, remember, that data scan of 400,000 is the biggest data scan the Scottish Government's received with regard to paying new benefits, Scottish Government benefits. So it's a very significant execution of a new benefit, and also an unprecedented in the history of Social Security Scotland receipt of a large data provision that we are then having to engage into our systems and pay out as quickly as possible. So that's all happening very successfully. Once we've paid all those benefits out, we can then actively report and consider what to do in the winter ahead, so the winter 23-24. But I've already instructed policy and programming officials to consider how we deliver the benefit in terms of timing for next winter. But of course, we need to engage with not just stakeholders, but also potentially our experience panels, and make sure that we get that appropriate feedback from people who've received the benefit, and what impact it had this winter before we undertake considerations about when we'd be, as part of our considerations as to when it would be best to be paid in the winter ahead.
I mean, I suppose my concern, Minister, is that can take months. So we're then into June, July. If you came to the view that you wanted to pay it, say, November, December, that gives DWP very little time to be able to pass that information on to you. So I'm wondering, have you at least highlighted the possibility with DWP at this stage that you might want to pay it in this calendar year, and asking them when is the break date that they need? So say, hypothetically, we said we wanted to make the payment in end of November, beginning of December. At what point does DWP need to know that so that they can provide the information? So do you have, so rather than you saying we want to pay it in November and make that decision in July, and DWP say, well, that's just not possible, we can't provide that quick enough, have you got a date from DWP to say, if you want to make the payment in November, we need to know that by where the date that is.
So officials in the Scottish Government and DWP speak regularly with regard to Social Security, and the points that you have raised are, of course, valid and important ones. I'd say that the officials in the Scottish Government that are engaged in programming and policy on winter heating payment, I have instructed to already consider what we do next winter, and that will include engagement with their DWP counterparts. In terms of the review, we will undertake that in an appropriate timescale, but also in a timescale that allows us to make sure that we are discussing the outcome of those considerations internally with our colleagues in DWP and, as necessary, to Parliament as well. So the way that you have set out how we engage with DWP, we do have, of course, to work collaboratively on timelines, and I spoke about that in the debate about the next phases of the programme. But we also need to discuss in a manner that is considerate of both our needs, and we will be engaging with DWP on the winter heating payment for next year once we have completed payment of this year's winter heating payment. So be assured that those discussions, in order to make sure that we have both orderly and timeous engagement with DWP ahead of next winter, in order to pay it at the right time that is agreed by both parties, in order to make sure that happens, will be undertaken appropriately.
Thank you very much, Minister. We will now move back to Faisal online.
Thank you, Convener. Can the data being used to calculate these figures be considered comprehensive when there is only a single reference month where, when analysing the financial pressure put on low-income households? Because we can see there's only 1 month reference.
I think I've already covered that point in my responses to Pam Duncan-Glancy and Paul McClellan. I don't know if I have anything further to add on those issues.
That's fine. Thank you, Minister. Yes, Faisal, those points have already been covered. Obviously, you can check the official record for that. We will now move on to theme three. And can I just, we are running slightly behind, so if I could ask members and the Minister to keep questions and answers relatively succinct and to the point. We'll move back to Jeremy.
Thank you. I think you've covered some of this already, Minister, so hopefully we can do it very quickly. I'm just wondering, looking forward, clearly, to some extent, the funding mechanism creates an incentive to follow DWP operating policy. Going forward, do you see a potential where the Scottish Government may take a different view? So we may do a higher figure or we may do a lower figure? And also, do you see a variation between different benefits? So clearly, again, you know, you've gone for the 10.1 across all the benefits. Could you see a day where maybe one benefit was uplifted more than another, so that it's more targeted? And how easy is that to do within the powers that you have?
Well, of course, I talked about this briefly in my opening remarks about where the obligations are for us to operate and where there's discretion. I think that's important to bear in mind. So under Section 86B of the Social Security Act 2018, which of course we passed in this Parliament just a few years ago, child disability payment, adult disability payment, funeral support payment are obligated and the Scottish Child Payment in order to operate within that. For the forthcoming care support payment, we will also consider that within the 2018 Act. Under Section 81 of the Act, carers' allowance supplement is there are the obligations within that. I mean, I think the Scottish Child Payment is a good example because, of course, we have increased that above inflation, above that statutory requirement. So that's a demonstration of that there can be a deviation. And then there are the exclusively Scottish benefits where there is a discretion to operate, and we have chosen to do that more last financial year by 6% instead of 3.1% for a number of them. And also this year we've uprated by 10.1%, even though there was not an obligation to do so. So the flexibility that you query has already been undertaken in certain circumstances.
I suppose my point was, I understand there's a statutory duty because of the bill, but as we roll these benefits out and as we look at it, do you think that's a helpful thing to have a statutory duty to have to do it, or would you rather have a greater discretion so that you can look at each? So, as you say, there are certain benefits we have to do by statute. Would it be helpful going forward as a kind of review as we see how the scheme works? But that wasn't a statutory duty, that government had discretion around that to look at different payments of how we should go up. Or are you happy to keep that statutory?
I'll bring Camilo in a minute, but the obligations under the Social Security Act 2018, I would not want to change. In that I think it's right that there's, as we agreed as a parliament, that there is an obligation to uprate those by CPI. But of course, in terms of the Scottish Child Payment, we have increased that above 10.1% in this period. So I don't know if you want to say any more, Camilla, about the obligations within the Act.
Thank you, Minister. Good morning, convener and committee members. Just on the legalities of the duty that the member mentioned there, there are two statutory duties in particular that the legislation that is before Parliament and which we're discussing today contemplate. The one that was mentioned by the Minister is in the Scotland Social Security Scotland Act 2018, section 86B, and that's an obligation, as the Minister mentioned, to uprate what is currently on the books is child disability payment, adult disability payment, funeral support payment and Scottish Child Payment. Now, that duty acts as, let's say, a minimal floor. The Minister did mention there's discretion to operate over and above that already. The policy point on whether there's a desire to keep that duty is not really for me to answer, but I think the Minister's mentioned it already.
I'll just say clearly that I would want...
And that was all I was looking for. I understand the legal behind it. I was wanting to see if you were happy with that, Minister, as is.
I am,
and you
yes.
are. Fine. I've got no more questions.
Thanks very much, Jeremy. I will now move to questions from our Deputy Convener, Emma Roddick, who has been waiting very patiently.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister and officials. As the Minister has already mentioned, uprating has been extended beyond those benefits where uprating had to happen. And we do have forecasts here from the SFC that there's a forecast of £776 million more being spent on Social Security than what is being received through the block grant. Could the Minister expand more on, firstly, any developments on those figures, as well as the challenges of deviating from DWP spending and how the decision was made to go over and above that?
To get to the heart of why those decisions have been made to go above is because the Scottish Government wants to use its powers over Social Security and its budgets to help as much as possible. It's a policy commitment that is at the heart of the Scottish Government's determination to make Scotland a better place and a fairer place. We see the mission to tackle poverty as a collective one for everyone in Scotland, government, business, Parliament, the third sector, wider civil society, public sector. It's all of our collective responsibility. And as part of that, of course, the government should utilise resource and power where it has it to make an impact. And that's why the commitment that we're making in the regulations before us today to operate not just those benefits where there is a statutory obligation to operate by CPI in the 2018 Act, but also those where we have discretion, I think is demonstrative of that commitment to provide additional support. Ministers across the government, particularly in the social justice portfolio and the finance portfolio, had our discussions in order to make sure that we were able to utilise the resources that we have and allocate that resource of £428 million to providing that additional support. And of course, I referred to the fact that last year we also operated our discretionary benefits, several of them, by a higher amount than CPI, in order to help people during the rising, during the position of rising cost of living at that time. And then, of course, there's also the Scottish Child Payment, not just an additional benefit, but one where we have increased it by 150% in year, as well as extended it hugely to over 300,000 children who are now eligible for it.
And thinking more about the cost of living crisis and the fact that CPI here, we're looking at a 10.1% increase, which is quite significant. The context there is, of course, it's difficult to describe as anything other than economic mismanagement has led us to this level of inflation. Is that figure higher than had been expected for this time? And is it higher than initially planned for, maybe?
Well, of course, the effects of the Truss government's decisions in the summer are borne out in fact of how much damage it caused to the UK economy and therefore the Scottish economy, the damage it caused to the financial markets and the knock-on effect that had on household costs and different costs from mortgages to therefore levels of rent, of course, which we took interventionist action on through legislation, to the impact on the UK government's ability to be able to respond in itself because of how the financial situation impacted their public finances. So, yeah, undoubtedly, the actions of the UK government in the last year have had an impact. I mean, that's just a matter of fact. I mean, of course, there are external factors like the war in Ukraine, and that's an important point to acknowledge. But also, the effect of Brexit is an important fact to acknowledge in this as well. So the level of inflation generally is something that this time last year, we would not have anticipated it to be at this level. Although, of course, there are projections that are undertaken, but the effects of what happened in the latter half of last year through political decision-making, bad political decision-making, definitely had an effect on where we are now, unfortunately. But that's why we have responded with our powers and resources to provide additional support in Scotland. And we all know how much of a difference that is making in all of the constituencies that we represent.
That's really helpful. And I've just got one final question, Convener. Thinking about the difference between the block grant and what is being spent, should there be, in the Minister's view, increased funding from the UK government, particularly given the cost of living crisis and the rate of inflation? And should the Scottish Government budget be inflation-proofed?
I think the... we've called for some time on the UK Government to provide additional support for low-income households. I mean, we have called for universal credit to be increased. And we, of course, argued strongly at the time that it should not have been reduced by £20, and now we're calling on it to be increased by £25, given the cost changes that have been since then. And the facts are in that situation that we're in right now, where inflation is where it's at, that, you know, the plain fact is that exceptional inflationary pressures means that the largely fixed budget we have available buys less. That's just the reality of the fiscal position that we're in, without the borrowing flexibilities that we talked about in response to Mr. McClellan. So we have had to allocate and prioritise appropriately within that fixed arrangement, largely fixed arrangement. Of course, we have created a more progressive situation in Scotland through the tax powers that we do have, and the social security decisions that we have made, and of course that was recognised in recent days by the IFS in their reporting. So there is a significant amount of extra support available for families in Scotland because of decisions that we've made. But the scale of the challenge is unlike anything that has been faced since the devolution of this Parliament recommenced in 1999. So we are in very significant times. But in those times, through the powers that we have, through Social Security Scotland that we created, people are getting more support right now all across Scotland, and that's making a difference, and that's really important.
Thank you. Supplementary from Miles on that point.
Thank you, Convener. I wasn't going to, but we've had a very political argument, which I don't think necessarily is then put into context Scotland's true finances. And I just wondered if the Minister wanted to put on record the Barnett formula providing an additional £2,000 in Scotland, which is allowing us to take these decisions compared to other parts of the United Kingdom, and global impact. I think he very briefly talked about the war in Ukraine, which on Friday it will be a year since that illegal invasion. Just wondered, this is global impacts, and we have not been, I'm not pretending in any way, cushioned by that, but just wondered, reality also needs to be taken on board when we're talking about these things, and fiscal positions, which sees our country spend £8 billion more, but the Barnett formula allows us to do that. Would he recognise that?
Well, I don't think we have time today, Convener, to go through the considerations around the Barnett formula. I mean, of course, there have been numerous debates, and there's a continuing debate about the Barnett formula and the allocations through the fiscal framework. And of course, Scotland, as a collective, through different taxations, pays in a very significant amount of money into the Treasury through its resources that is not something to underestimate. So,
in pure economic terms, there are £8 billion less than we spend.
I think there are important considerations around the fact that the Barnett formula, of course, is a situation for considerations around the fiscal framework, but also it is also a fact that Scotland has paid in a surplus of resource in years past into the UK Treasury. So, I think we need to bear the wider considerations in mind when considering these points. But what I would emphasise is that Scotland is making political choices within its devolved settlement in order to provide additional support. We have also had to make decisions to mitigate against UK government policy that is costly for Scotland, and particularly aspects like the bedroom tax, which costs tens of millions of pounds every year that we would rather not have to spend, and it would be much better if we could get rid of that policy, for example. So that is also a reality of the situation. I acknowledge the international situation, I would never pretend that the war in Ukraine, the illegal invasion, which of course we all wish didn't happen and wasn't happening, of course, I recognise the effect that that's having, but in the same way that that is a reality, it is also a reality that Brexit is having an effect on the situation with regard to inflation and the strength of the UK economy, as is the repercussions of the decisions of the Truss government in that brief period of time.
Thank you, Minister, and thank you, Miles. Pam, I know you have a supplementary on this. If I could ask you to keep it brief, just because we are kind of moving into things that are a much wider discussion than what we're kind of focusing on in the committee this morning. But on you go.
Thank you, I appreciate that. And that was what my supplementary was about. We are going into things that are far wider than this. And I think that was, when we spent a bit of time talking about it from one perspective, it was fine to do so, but we're now told it's not fine to do so from another. So it's just to raise that and say that actually these things, if they matter from a much broader perspective than what was raised. I can go straight into my next theme, if that's helpful. Thank you. As the Minister and other members will be aware, the SSI that we're looking at today, or the raises carers allowance earnings limit to £139.9, which is any raise in the context of some of the figures I set out earlier on is really helpful. But in the government's consultation on carers assistance, the proposed increase to the amount that carers could earn whilst receiving Scottish carers assistance, which of course is still being delivered through the DWP on agency agreement, could be linked to 16 hours at the real living wage, which would be £174. Has the Minister considered that figure as opposed to 139? Why hasn't he taken the opportunity to put more money in the pockets of unpaid carers who are really, really struggling right now?
Convener? Yeah. So thank Pam Duncan Glancy for the question. And I also am conscious that I have to respond formally to that consultation still. And I would be grateful if we can consider these matters once I've formally responded to that consultation, because it's important in terms of process that that happens first. And then I'm very happy to engage on those points thereafter.
I appreciate that there's a live consultation, but does the Minister accept that unpaid carers are really, really struggling and any increase could be helpful? The figure I've chosen is the one that you've proposed in that consultation. I'm not asking you to preempt the conclusions, but I think it's fair to assume that unpaid carers would accept that more money is needed. And I'm just asking whether or not that figure was considered.
We do also need to consider that case transfer needs to be undertaken when it comes to carers allowance and introducing our new benefit care support payment. So we will be, of course, are undertaking that process of delivering a carer support payment, which will be the next benefit that the Scottish Government delivers. The determination that we have to support carers is, of course, demonstrated in the carers allowance supplement, which we've paid since 2018, and the additional support that we paid in 21 and 20. We want to support carers within the financial restraints that we have as much as we can, and that's why the threshold on the consultation on carers allowance or carer support payment is an important piece of work. It's why it includes a number of improvements that we hope to make from launch, from completion of case transfer, and then in due course. And I look forward to discussing that with Parliament once the consultation responses have been published, because it is a really important new benefit. We want to make the difference that we can with it. And part of that is, of course, level of payment and the amount that we're able to provide and support within the financial realities and constraints that the government faces. Now, I think that it is important to bear in mind that just like with adult disability payment, there is a process of case transfer that needs to be completed, a very challenging process of case transfer. But once we're able to do that, hopefully as quickly as possible, that's certainly the intention, to undertake case transfer as timeously as we can. And then thereafter, once everyone is in one system, well, then we'll be able to think collectively about what improvements can be made at that juncture within the financial constraints that we face.
I appreciate that, and I understand the case transfer point, and of course that's why the Carers Alliance is still being delivered by the DWP, so I get that. But can I ask the Minister why they chose £139 and not £174.40?
So the fact that the eligibility criteria for our carer support payment when it launches will broadly mirror carers allowance until we have transferred everyone's awards. That's the reality, because we cannot have a two-tier system, just like we cannot have a two-tier system between adult disability payment and personal independence payment until case transfer is completed.
Can I ask how there would be a two-tier system just now? Because my understanding is all of carers allowance is being paid by the UK government, so there would be a difference. That two-tier would be one tier in Scotland, one tier in the rest of the UK, which I think we can all accept as a point of devolution. But so I don't understand that justification.
Because within this financial year, we will start carer support payments, so there will be new applications.
Okay. Thank you. I have no further questions on that point. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Pam, and thank you, Minister. That concludes our questions for that item. So we will now move on to agenda item 3, which is the formal consideration of motion S6M07737, that the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recommends that the Social Security Uprating Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2023 be approved. I invite the Minister to speak and move this motion.
Formally moved.
Thank you, Minister. I now invite any further contributions from members. Okay, I now invite the Minister to sum up and probably not respond to the debate.
thank colleagues for their important questions, and I hope they support these regulations.
Thank you. So the question is that motion S6M07737 in the name of Ben McPherson MSP be approved. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much. We will move to agenda item 4, which is the formal consideration of motion S6M07738, that the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recommends that the Social Security Uprating Scotland Order 2023 be approved. Again, I would invite the Minister to speak and move this motion.
Formally moved.
And I will invite contributions from members. No. So I would invite the Minister to sum up.
Thank you for your important questions on these regulations as well, and I hope you'll support them.
Thank you. So the question is that motion S6M07738 in the name of Ben McPherson MSP be approved. Are we all agreed? Thank you all. The committee will report on the outcome of both instruments in due course, and I invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to approve a draft of the report for publication. Agreed. Thank you, Minister. And thank you to your officials. I will now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for officials for the next agenda item to join us online. Thank you. Welcome back. We are now going to consider our next agenda item, a Legislative Consent Memorandum, or LCM, on the UK Parliament's Social Security Additional Payments No. 2 Bill. I welcome back Ben McPherson, MSP, Minister for Social Security and Local Government. And I also welcome officials who are joining us remotely, Susan Sutar, Reserved Benefits Policy Manager, and Kayleigh Blair, Solicitor, both Scottish Government. So, Minister, I understand that you would like to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener and colleagues, for the opportunity to discuss with you this legislative consent motion for the Social Security Additional Payments No. 2 Bill. That bill was introduced by the UK Government on the 7th of February to provide further payments to support people through the cost of living crisis, which is support that's extra and we welcome it. The help available includes £900 in extra costs of living payments for those on means-tested benefits, which will be paid in three stages over the financial year 23-24. Those in receipt of non-means-tested disability benefits include people who receive child disability payment and adult disability payment from Social Security Scotland, and they will receive a disability cost of living payment of £150. This payment will be made in summer 2023. Our analysis suggests that around 750,000 households in Scotland will receive the means-tested additional payment and around 680,000 individuals will receive the disability additional payment. It is the view of the UK Government that the provisions of their bill are reserved and they have therefore not requested the Scottish Parliament's consent to the bill. However, the view of the Scottish Government is that the bill relates to devolved matters. It is my view that the payments are provided to individuals who have a short-term need for financial support to avoid a risk to their well-being, and that this can be legislated for within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament. That is why it is necessary to lodge a legislative consent motion, although the UK Government has not requested one. In doing so, we will ensure that the devolution settlement is properly respected, and more importantly, that a precedent for overriding the devolution settlement is not established. The alternative to a legislative consent motion would be to pass legislation in the Scottish Parliament to an extremely truncated timescale in order to match the UK Government's timetable and ensure payments are made when introduced. The legislation would need to come into force by the end of March. The UK Government bill will apply to the entirety of the UK. As a result, it is my view that introducing legislation in the Scottish Parliament is not necessary and nor proportionate. Instead, the most prudent course of action is to provide legislative consent to the provisions within the UK Bill, and this will support the payments while ensuring that the devolution settlement is properly respected. I welcome the opportunity to take any questions as part of your consideration of this LCM.
Thank you very much, Minister. I'll now invite questions from members and I'll move first to Pam.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for setting out the Government's position on the cost of living payments and the legislative consent. If it is the view of the Scottish Government that it is within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament to pass legislation to provide payments to people in Scotland as set out in the bill, can I ask why they haven't done so?
Of course, we need to undertake, first, is, as I've referenced before, is to make sure that we first undertake the delivery of adult disability payment, which of course was nationally rolled out on the 29th of August 2022 all across Scotland, and of course undertaking complete the case transfer process of individuals on personal independence payment and disability living allowance for working age adults in Scotland into adult disability payment, which is underway. So we need to undertake that process. Once everyone is in Social Security, is in the Scottish system, then considerations around the future are, of course, matters that we will all consider, which is also related to why we are consulting on adult disability payment, and of course that consultation is currently live.
Thank you, I appreciate that answer. The question though is not so much about adult disability payment or benefits that are currently being delivered, it's about whether or not the Scottish Government believed that paying a one-off payment in times of hardship, as you've just described, using clause 7, why the Scottish Government hasn't done that.
Well, we need to undertake case transfer first.
I don't understand how, because the Scottish Government has data on who are on low incomes in Scotland. We've got that through various different mechanisms, including local authorities. So if the Scottish Government believe that this legislation impinges on devolved legislation, then they are accepting that there is a responsibility in devolved legislation to make payments to people in times of hardship. So my question is, why haven't you?
So, of course, we provide additional support in Scotland that isn't available elsewhere in the UK through our child winter heating assistance, for example, which, of course, we introduced. So initiatives has been undertaken to provide extra support. The CARES allowance supplement, which we talked about with regard to the last set of regulations. And, of course, there are further considerations through future primary legislation that we will be able to consider what we wish or do not wish to do as a parliament in terms of how we continue to develop Scotland's social security system. But when it comes to adult disability payment, the focus has been on the safe and secure delivery of our new payment, adult disability payment, which, as I said, was nationally introduced from the 29th of August, and undertaking case transfer safely and securely.
I appreciate that. The child winter heating assistance and the Scottish child payment and the benefits that you've referred to are all sort of steady state benefits. They're not benefits that are only paid because we're in a cost of living crisis, like the ones in the legislation that there is a legislative consent motion brought to. So that's the point I'm getting at. Why, if it is in the devolved competence of the Scottish Parliament and Scottish Government, why have they not given additional cost of living payments to these groups of people?
Well, as I said, that would require a piece of primary legislation to have been passed by this Parliament. It would have required additional financial resource to be found within a restricted budget. Of course, where we have been able to allocate additional resource using already established mechanisms, we've provided additional support where we can, and then of course we also passed a bill in order to be able to pay the carers allowance additional supplement in 2021, and we of course also introduced the Scottish child payment from 2019 into 2021 with the initial under 60s, and then of course the full rollout to under 16s. So we have used existing mechanisms and created new mechanisms to provide additional support, but primary legislation would be required with regard to what Pam Duncan Glancy refers to. Susan, I don't know if you want to come in on anything further on that point.
Thank you, Minister. No, I think you've probably covered off everything that in terms of the additional support already being provided by the Scottish Government, and the fact that these are UK Government payments, and it would obviously be more effective and more cost effective for them to come from a single source, which is the UK Government in this particular instance. And obviously Scottish Government officials are working closely with DWP officials in order to ensure that the payments do go out to Scottish clients.
Thank you.
Thanks, Pam. Now move to Jeremy.
Yeah, no question, Karina, but just again to refer to the interest I noted under the previous item.
Thank you very much.
And interest as well. I'm in receipt of personal independence payment. Thank you. Sorry, I hadn't mentioned that.
Thank you for putting that on the record, Pam. Thank you. So I thank the Minister and officials for taking part in this meeting to help inform our report on the LCM, which we will publish shortly. We'll now move into private, and can members who are joining us remotely please use the Microsoft Teams link in their calendars to join the meeting. Thank you.